80% of the same amount of business the year before, same time period, were still happening during the one of the scariest moments, probably the scariest, definitely one of the scariest moments, you know, in our lifetime, right? In the last 100 years, whatever. That's how every new agent is, right? They come in, they're excited, you know, sky's the limit, great opportunity, okay? They go through this same cycle, okay? You're gonna be excited, then after a while, you're gonna realize there's so much to learn and you can't learn it all in a day and you become frustrated, okay? Then you get to the part where you don't sell a property in the first month or two and you become disappointed. So it's like this, really excited, you know, then you start become frustrated and then disappointed. And then, this is where a lot of people quit right then. But if you can stomach that and take a look around at that moment and say, okay, this is harder than I thought, but look at all these agents that are succeeding and crushing it. So I know it can be done, okay? So then you have a second win, and now you're excited again. You're like, okay, this is harder than I thought, but I can do it. Okay, let me get back at it. Now you're excited again. Now you go through the whole thing over again. You become excited, frustrated, and disappointed, right? The first curve is massive. Then the second one's not as big, right? And then it gets to a point where you're kind of leveled out and you understand the reality. You know, you have to be careful because a lot of people do 100% training, and they're not doing anything to build their business, right? And then they're way behind because we need momentum now. You know, we need momentum yesterday, day before, and we're not doing anything to build momentum. We're chalking it up to we're learning the business. And we got to learn the business, but we also have to build momentum in our business. You know, we're not going to make it. How big do you guys think your business would be if you had 5,000 property owners in your market getting a weekly email from you? They had a great first impression of you. They liked you. They gave you their contact. And you got 5,000 of those. This isn't like Zillow leads, internet leads, you know, people that never called you back. These are people that gave you their information, they own property in your market, right? And after that great first impression, they get a weekly email from you every single week on the same day of the week from that point forward. How big do you think your business will be? How massive do you think it will be? Or how small do you think it will be? If you look at the dot-com crash, 2008, the pandemic, right? Pandemic's a great example. 80% of the same amount of deals were not only closing, but there was still 80% of the same amount of deals going under contract during the worst part of the shutdown. March, or half of April and March. 80% of the same amount of business the year before, same time period, were still happening during one of the scariest moments, probably the scariest, definitely one of the scariest moments, you know, in our lifetime, right? In the last 100 years, whatever. 80%. Guys, I mean, if that doesn't open your eyes up to the fact that closings happen every day regardless of what happens, right? So then you get into this mindset that, okay, I have job security forever. Like, closings will never stop. So then you don't have to worry about crashes, interest rates, supply, demand, all these factors that you have zero control over, okay? So then it comes down to, am I going to wake up every day and make 5 new friends of property owners every day for 4 years? That's it. And do a weekly email, when it's really as simple as who has the most friends in the market, right? At the end of a deal, you ask the buyer and seller, how'd you pick your agent? The most common answer is going to be, I had a friend in the business. That's the most common answer, especially now after you've went through a cycle of the online stuff where most people pick their agent online for a little while when digital really hit the scene. We've been through that cycle. People don't like picking out just a random agent online. They want to deal with somebody they trust because maybe a couple people have bad experiences with just picking random agents. So now we're through that initial cycle of digital, right? Now we're back to who's got the most friends in the market. And when you operate like this, it doesn't matter if Zillow bought showing time or, you know, Redfin's doing flat fees or, you know, for sale by owners or it, none of that matters. none of that matters all of a sudden, right? When you build your business, you know, the right way, this is the right way. The best way, the most efficient way, the most cost efficient way, the most efficient, scalable way. When you do a weekly email and that's how you stay in touch with your people, you can scale that. It doesn't matter if you have 5, 50, 500, 5 million. It still takes you 30 minutes a week to build that email, send it out. Once we have that in place, then we can, if we want to do social media, we can build that on top of, in addition to supplement the weekly email. But not in place of, or not, shouldn't be the foundation of, in my opinion. I'm just telling you what my experience is and telling you guys what I think. You put it on MLS. If you want to call the other airplane hangar people around it, great. Now, let's let the market take care of that. It's done deal. Let's go get some more listings, right? We need like 10, 15 more listings today. You know what I mean? Going back to Randy, how are we going to get a listing this week? We got to get out there and make some more friends. That's what we need to be focused on. But yeah, I hate to answer it like that because it's kind of an indirect answer, but it is the truth. You know, commercial real estate's done completely different than residential. Okay, that's a whole different ball game. Those guys have a different MLS. Those guys network with each other. There's a lot of stuff done behind the scenes. You know, with residential, you need thousands and thousands and thousands of clients getting that weekly email to kind of keep the momentum to where you're hitting those goals and everything. In commercial, all you need is a good 20, 30, you know, great investor clients. You know, and they're buying and selling stuff from you, you know, constantly, you know. So commercial is a totally different ball game than residential. You know, when I'm using that script, I'm thinking if I'm a seller, somebody calls me with that, you know, basically that's the agent saying, hey, Mr. Seller, you don't know me, I don't know you, but will you sell your house so I can make some money? And if not, then get out of my way and give me all the people that you might know that might want to buy or sell. And the seller's thinking, okay, I don't know you. Right? I'm definitely not going to, you know, let you make money off my house. And I'm certainly not going to give you any contact information of anybody I know. I don't even know you. And here we are in the very first conversation trying to get referrals off somebody that we never even met. They have zero, you know, zero proof that we even know what we're doing or that we're even in real estate. And we're just calling them on the phone kind of deal. Right? And so it's geared towards what can the prospect do for the agent? And what my scripts and my philosophy is hey, what can the agent do for the prospect? See, I'm 180-ing the entire philosophy of the business in terms of prospecting here. What can we do for the prospect? Not what can the prospect do for us? Here's the punchline. No one's ever been fined in history, right? No one's ever been fined, number one. Number two, we're calling people up to inform them something sold and ask if there's anything we can do to help. Totally legal, if you read the rules. Totally legal, right? And I could tell you probably five or six other more things that make this thing null and void. But let's go back to the main punchline. No one's ever been fined, period. Now, you've got lawyers that have tried to sue and try to scare people into paying $500 and stuff like that. But, you know, in my opinion, the reason why no one's ever been fined is because if someone were to be fined, that entity, whoever fined the person, would get sued big time. That's why, how can you say you can't call somebody, you know, and what you were calling about and what the premise was and so on and so forth. It's just so far out there in left field. So it scares a lot of people, but really the DNC numbers are the best quality. Those are your cell phone numbers. Those are your really best quality numbers.